This is where I grew up at. Projects.
I'm here. I'm here. I'm here. Hey, even when the property ain't covered, man, let's go.
Up, up in the way. Hey, do you trust me? Would you love me? Then it must be.
Here we go. This is where I grew up at. Projects. Man, everything was competition where I'm from, and that's part of the reason, you know, I was able to make it to the NFL. Like, everything was some form of competition, and when I'm looking back on it in retrospect, it all helped me with the skills necessary to be an NFL player. The agility, the quickness, and all those things. Like, when I was like a teenager and I started going to like football camps, I'd come outside. That was Chuck, that was my house right there. I'd come outside and I'd run from this pole to that pole, practicing my 40. So I get down, set, go, practice my 40 in a straight line. And I could always feel it before camp. I could always feel like, if I was gonna run like a 4.3 or 4.4, whatever I was running out here, I could always feel it. And check this out. Years ago, my mom bought this to kind of like, I didn't even think it would still be here. My mom bought this to kind of like add some aesthetic to the house. These bricks right here gotta be 15 years old. And so, you know what I used to do? Everything was makeshift. Like this 40, it was like a makeshift 40. This was like a makeshift ladder for me. So I used to like practice my footwork. Excuse me, cat. I used to practice my footwork on this. It was crazy. Like I'd do little like ladder drills right here. Everything was makeshift. I used to practice my vert right here. Cause you gotta think, when I was young, I was obviously shorter. So this is how I would practice my vert. I'd be jumping. And I like, I touch that. I do pull-ups. I go here. That's how I did my pull-ups. I made everything into a makeshift practice session. So I used to practice my routes, believe it or not, right here. So if I had a slant, I'd envision it. Like, a huge part of being a route runner is creativity. That's a huge part of being a route runner. Like, you gotta be creative enough to run a route in a way that you could get open. And when I used to get bored sometimes, I used to practice my routes on these little concrete type of things. So if I had a slant, I'd be like, okay, I got a 3-step slant. When I cut this slant, I want it to be perfect in this angle. And I run that slant.
Myself, of course, you know, you go some.
Yeah, I know.
And you know what? I don't watch football.
I know,
you know,
I know.
I'm totally ignorant about
this. This is Miss Sylvia. She's over the Barnyard, Camp Barnyard, the after school program. This is the hub. Yeah. This is the place that molded us all from the Grove. Like, this place
really?
Is like,
well, we were here for you, and really it was you kids that started this program.
And it was free.
You started this program because when this was a program for adults in 1982, and children from the neighborhood started coming in. And those children were like Travis and Folly and David and some other kids from the neighborhood, and they just came in and said, here we are, we need something to do. So I started working with them, and eventually we turned into a program. But, you know, it wasn't my brilliant idea of starting a program for children. It was you kids that were the ones that said, here we are, you need to do something for us. And so we did. We answered that need. So, and then the Barnyard was started, and here we are, 37, 38, dang, maybe 39 years later.
Things I didn't know about the Boneyard. Started in 1982. I didn't start coming to the Boneyard until I was five. I was born in 94, so I came in 99.
Yeah, yeah.
I was young. Thank you for everything you've done for
us. I'm sorry, sweetheart, that I didn't recognize you.
It's okay. I know you don't watch football. Yeah. So, yeah, it's called the Barnyard. As you can see, like, it goes up like a barnyard. Like, if you see the doors and stuff like that. For Christmas and stuff like that, to have the firefighters, they would come park out there and bring gifts, and we would come stand in the line and receive gifts. And we used to be broken down into groups. And in the summer, you know, we'd do like stuff to prepare us for the next grade. But we all came here. Everybody came in the summer for one reason, the field trips. Like, we used to go to the skating rink. We used to go to Parrot Jungle. We used to go to Alligator Alley, I think it was called, see the alligators and stuff like that. It was the best field trips ever at the Barnyard. Like, when I look back on things, this is my whole life. They always influenced us to read. Always influenced us to be scholars. Always influenced us to be more. And it wasn't just sports.
What's up? What's your name?
Derek.
Can I get an autograph? Can you sign my phone?
Yeah, I got you. What you is? What you group you in?
Can you sign my phone?
You in the Jaguars? What group you in?
I'm in, I'm supposed to be in Jaguar, but they moved me down.
You got something to sign it with?
No.
So I'm gonna sign it with my finger.
Yes. I mean, Amari, you.
Oh, y'all got iPhones. How old are you? Yeah, come on. How old are you?
I am 10.
How you got an iPhone? Let me see. Come on. You ready?
Yeah. Oh, I'm.
Hey, can you show my shirt when I get it?
Yeah, he's the same Camp Barnyard shirt from back in the day too. Same one.
What on my shirt from back in the day too?
From back in the day, same. I had the same shirt.
Do
I think I could route you?
Of course I don't.
I'm telling you this.
Let me ask you this. Do you think I could route you? Do you think I could route you? You play football?
You came here.
Who you play for? Play for the girl. What position you play?
It's a tight end.
What pound you play?
12.
12 you?
Whose song is it?
Yeah. Oh, y'all don't even know me.
Y'all parents gonna be mad. Cause these, I remember these Camp Barnyard shirts by 15. How much these Camp Barnyard?
Six.
Six? Okay.
Get that cheap.
You're gonna have to buy another shirt. They're gonna be mad at y'all.
Yep.
You gonna be on Route Runners TV. Yep.
I gotta get a Sharpie back.
Yep, I'm with. I'm on TV.
You're going to be on Route Runners TV.
Bye.
Go run a route, because you're talking about you a tight end.
I'm going to go ahead and post, all right?
Get in your stance first. I'm the quarterback.
I'm going to lock down corner.
Down. Get in your stance.
All right, bro.
Sit. Hey. Ah.
I'm a quarterback.
That was perfect. You jammed your hand. Right here. You gotta catch the ball. Let me see. Here, you gotta catch. All right.
I got you. Say go.
You ain't ready. You got on Uggs. Say go. Oh yeah, I like that. Ooh. Hey, he might have something. You know, obviously with so many sports brewing at the Barnyard and in the Grove, couldn't take full advantage of every sport. So my main three sports was football, basketball, and track. But you know, they had teachers like this coming to teach us tennis. But it was never really a sport that I could focus on, because if you think about it, football, basketball, and track, those three put you in a sport year round. So when track season was over, I'm going to football. When football season over, I'm going to basketball. So I didn't have time for tennis, even though I dabbled in it a little bit. I didn't have time for boxing. We had boxing at the Powell gym, all within walking distance, but I didn't really have that time, but I dabbled in it. We had everything, bro. We had hockey. We in Miami, we had hockey. So, but yeah, this is where I can show you the exact spot where I learned how to catch. So, it'll be times throughout the year where we would take these down and just play football either this way or this way, right? And everybody wanted to play football at the Boneyard, so, you know, we made room for everybody to play, and this is where I learned how to catch, right here. I was probably in the spot he at right now.
Are you ready?
And my man G,
Swing.
G was at quarterback. He was in the red over there. And I ran a route, a stop route. Ooh. He threw the ball, and I caught it like this. I jumped and caught it with my chest. He was like, what you doing? He stopped, and it was a teaching moment. What you doing? I'm like, what you mean? Like, I caught the ball. He was like, nah, you don't catch like that. You catch with your hands. You put your hands like this in like a diamond shape, and you catch it, you look it through, and you tuck it. And that's where I learned how to catch. Shout out to G. Shout out to G. Okay. We got the kiddie court for basketball. We got here where we played football. And then we got over there where we played basketball. Let me show y'all. We call this the Cinerator right here. I don't even know why it's called the Cinerator, but that's what we called it. This is what we played, man. I got my first dunk here. My first dunk was on this court right here. You got all these different courts. My first dunk was on this one. Ninth grade. This is where I learned how to hoop, and I used to, man. So I don't know if y'all see the lights, right? Y'all see all the lights up there. I took basketball so serious because I thought I would, man, I thought I would play in the NBA and the NFL. That's how I felt. And this was so close to where I lived that I used to be out here all night till the lights went off practicing my game. So a lot of my releases come from basketball and vice versa. How I high point the ball, I get that from rebounding the ball. Like, I made both sports coincide with one another, football and basketball. So I'd be out here all night working on my crossover, the Tim Hardaway crossover, whatever crossover. And I'd be out here just practicing till the lights went off. And then I got this habit of practicing when the lights went off, because they say if you can shoot when you can barely see the rim, you're a real shooter. So I started doing that. But yeah, the Cinerator, man. Shout out to the Cinerator. The current residents, I think they said they'll let us inside just so y'all can see the inside of where I grew up. So. Ready for us?
Yeah, go ahead.
All right. So here it is. This the kitchen. This was just same thing. We used to have these noodles. This is like all we had. My favorite was the chicken, but I done ate so many noodles that they all my favorite now. So that's the back door. It's the front door right here. It ain't that big, you know what I mean? I grew up with three sisters, one brother, and then my mom. So it was always five of us. But the thing is, my older sister, she's 10 years older than me. And she had my niece when I was 8, so I was still in elementary school. So it's a 2-bedroom, 1-bathroom. My mom had this room. We all had that room. But when I was in elementary school and my sister had her child, it was my mom in that room, my sister and her child in that room, and all of us slept in here on the couch. We had a big pull-out couch. We all slept in here. So I didn't sleep in the bed from maybe like 8 to 18. I didn't sleep in the bed for 10 years. I slept on the couch for 10 years. And I ain't play by my couch. Like, when it was time, if it was like 9 o'clock and I was getting sleepy, watch out. Y'all gotta get out my couch. Y'all gotta get out my couch. You know what I'm saying? Like, that was my spot. This is after the pullout couch, of course. When we stopped having that pullout couch and we just had a couch, I slept on the couch. Everybody else slept where they slept. And I ain't played by my couch, man. So, man, I remember my first day moving here. First day moving to the project, I was 4 years old. And I remember vividly, like, I came in this room, which ended up being my mom's room. And we had moved the bed in already. So I, like, put my knees on the bed, and I just looked out this window. And I was looking out this window for, like, 5 minutes. And I don't know why I remember this so vividly, but I'm often thinking about this memory. I was just real hopeful. Like, I don't know why. Like, I was real hopeful and optimistic about being in this place. And I was looking out the window like, this is going to be a good place. Like, I'm going to make a lot of friends. It's going to be a happy place. And I was just looking out this window. But, you know, in retrospect, it kind of feel like it has, like, a deeper meaning. Like, I was looking forward to something, you know what I mean? Like, I still don't know what that something is, but that's like my earliest memory of living here. So this is our room right here. Like I said, bro, like, I don't know how we did it, because it seemed so small, but looking back, it was a lot of arguments. But now I know why. We wasn't a dysfunctional family. It was space. Like, everybody was in each other's way. That's why everybody was arguing so much. Shout out to my sisters, man. But I'm looking at it now. I don't know how we fit 2 bunk beds in here. It was a bunk bed here. It was a bunk bed here when we was young, before my older sister had her first child. Us 4 used to sleep in here on the bunk beds. Then when she had her child, you can imagine, like, this room, like, all us couldn't fit in here, you know what I mean? But this was our closet right here. Man, it seemed like it was so much bigger. It seemed like it was so much bigger. This is our closet. One time a frog came through that window. Never forget. Frog came through that window. We was up all night trying to kill it. We had a shovel. We had some raid. We went to work. It took us like an hour, but we got it.
You can't sleep peacefully.
No, no, no. We couldn't go to sleep. We couldn't go. All you heard was, where's that? Where's that? Where's it? Rip it. Rip it. There it go. Spray it. Spray it. Spray it. Ha. 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 And we got that thing. So, yeah.
Yeah, man.
We used to have a lot of tournaments in here. So, growing up, I never had a game system. But we had a Nintendo 64. When it first came out, and then the PS1 came out, we still had the Nintendo 64. The PS2 came out, we still had the PS3. But when we had the Nintendo 64, we used to Mario go-kart. Like, we used to have, that was one of my vivid memories from this room. Like, we used to have little tournaments in here on the Mario go-kart, Madden. Yeah. A little space for the, but we used to keep our dirty clothes here, right? And a quick story, I had my first banquet after my first year playing football, so I was like maybe seven years old, something like that. And the thing about us, like, we didn't have a lot. Like, we in the projects right now, you know, everybody is like poor in the projects, but we was always like one of the poorest. And so one of my earliest memories from this area right here is we had a banquet, and I was never really able to go places like to a banquet because I never had nothing to wear. You know what I'm saying? So go to the banquet. I was one of the best players on the team that year. And I'm like, I gotta go to the banquet. I might win MVP. You know what I'm saying? I ain't have nothing to wear. Got 3 sisters. Go in the dirty clothes. I said, I'm going to find something to wear for this banquet. I go in the dirty clothes. I'm pulling clothes out. I know I ain't got no jeans. I know I don't have no jeans. But my sister Ashley got some jeans. Because her daddy used to get us some stuff. So found these jeans. I ain't know no better. I'm 7 years old. Put them on. Put on a shirt. I go to the banquet. All I hear, everybody laughing. Kiki. Ha, ha, ha. I'm like, man, what they laughing at? Bro hit me like, who jeans them is? I said, hey, my jeans, what you mean? whole time they bell bottom jeans. So they skinny here and they getting wide at the bottom. I don't know no better. I just want to go to the banquet and hopefully win this MVP. So everybody clowning me. I ain't even win MVP. So I'm like, I ain't even have to come. I just got a participation trophy. Coming back from the banquet, walking back, everybody following me, like 10 people following me. Boy got on his sister jeans. Boy got on the bell bottom jeans. Blah, I'm like, oh man. So yeah, I got clowned that day, but yeah, that's one of the memories. That's one of the memories from this spot. And this is the it's the bathroom, man. Oh, same exact mirror. This is one of the mirrors you can open. You know what I'm saying? But it's the same one. My mama used to always, she used to give me a lot of chores because I had three sisters. But sometimes she'd make me clean the bathroom because I was real meticulous. She used to be like, man, I love the way he cleaned that mirror. In retrospect, though, I realize now she was just complimenting me so that I can want to clean up. But back then when she told me, man, Mari cleaned that mirror so good, every time she told me to clean the bathroom, I'd be same light, same everything, man. It's crazy, y'all. We used to have so many roaches. One time my niece that my older sister had, she saw a roach crawling on the wall and she ate that thing. She threw up though. And I remember, shout out to Harry, he's like an avuncular figure in my life. He was always around. I remember he painted it this color. It's like, what? I'm bad with colors. It's like an orange type of color. Remember he painted it this color. Just a lot of stuff is the same. I haven't lived here since I was like 16. We was very poor, but how Miami is structured, even on the outside, on the outskirts of Coconut Grove where I'm from, it's a pretty affluent neighborhood. And that always gave me a whole bunch of hope. And it taught me so much. It taught me how to be resilient. It taught me how to be patient because success was right there. It's like I could almost grab it. I didn't have it yet, but I could see it. This is what you call a misconception. Like I was saying earlier, somebody see my Coconut Grove chain, they'll Google Coconut Grove, and this is the stuff they'll see. The rich, because it was so close to me. So look, we one street removed from Charles Terrace. We one street removed from Charles Terrace. And y'all gonna see the houses start getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Any type of house you want. Look at this house already. One street removed from the projects. And so I would just walk around. Although growing up in the projects was so, it felt hopeless at times. Oh, walk around here. Look at that. You see that Porsche? They got a Porsche in their yard. I mean, in their driveway. A modern style house. One street removed from the projects. So it was almost like I could reach out and I could grab it. It was like so close, but yet so far away. But it was filled with hope. And it was on one of these walks. I'm just telling y'all my truth. It was on one of these walks where I asked myself, what do I have to do to get that? I took that question real seriously. And how did I beat that obstacle as a route runner? Everything that was contrary to getting this, I stopped doing or I didn't do. everything that was conducive to getting this, making better grades, going to school. Yeah, even going to school. Working hard. Like, you can ask any of my coaches, like, when it was time to do runs after practice or push-ups, everything like that, I'm going hard because I really took that question serious. How do I get this? Got to work hard for it. How do I get this? Got to go to school. How do I get this? Got to make better grades. How do I get this? Got to be smart. How do I do this? Got to make good decisions. But that goes back to that book, The Outliers 2. The book Outliers 2. This was, believe it or not, even though I didn't grow up in these houses, this was an advantage and an opportunity that I had that other people who grew up in other projects across the United States probably didn't have. They didn't live this close to this. We still 5 minutes into our walk. Believe it or not, this was an advantage that I had because a lot of kids can't even see a way out. And I don't like to make my struggle seem like it was more than the next guy's. Like, I'm gonna tell you the truth. Like, I had an advantage, the advantage of seeing stuff like this and saying, man, that's this close. I could have that. That's just a fact. That's just a fact.